If we don't begin to change the way we think on how we approach the issues, then we will find that even though we've done a lot of work and we've put in a lot of effort, it may not necessarily have the desired outcomes.
Hello and welcome to this episode of She Stands for Peace, the podcast series that explores the state of the women, peace and security agenda in Africa through a series of dialogues with key actors. I am Dr. Yemisi Akinbobola, your host, and today I'm joined by Hanna Tetteh, Special Representative of the Secretary General to the African Union and Head of the United Nations Office to the African Union. The focus of this episode is Partnerships for Peace. Thank you for joining us, SRSG Hanna Tetteh. Would you like to start by telling us about yourself and your role as Special Representative of the Secretary General to the African Union and the Head of the United Nations Office to the African Union?
Thank you very much, Yemisi. I am the Special Representative of the Secretary General to the African Union, and essentially what my function is to oversee the office of the United Nations to the African Union, and to, together with my colleagues, to work on the implementation of the partnership between the United Nations and the African Union on peace and security. We have a framework agreement on peace and security that was signed between the United Nations and the African Union in 2017. And that framework guides the actions, the programs, the initiatives that we work on and we develop in partnership with the African Union. Because the United Nations and the African Union are both important multilateral organizations, this is an institutional partnership that facilitates the way in which the two organizations are able to streamline their work together on matters of peace and security, doing joint analysis, doing horizon scanning surveys, working together to determine what would possibly be the best joint response on peace and security challenges within the African continent, but also doing this with other UN and African Union offices, funds, programs, agencies that also have the mandate of working on peace and security issues on the continent. So in summary, that's what I would say is the role that I have at the present time.
Okay. So I want us to unpack some of the things that you said there, because I think within that there's so many facets of partnership building around peace building and conflict resolution in Africa. So firstly, I want to look more broadly at UNOAU as an organization and how you would describe its role and its position in the implementation of the Women, Peace and Security Agenda in Africa. So how would you describe its role and its position, particularly when we consider that bridging between the two organizations of the AU and the UN?
Well, the Women, Peace and Security Agenda is an important part of the Peace and Security Agenda. For a very long time, prior to the year 2000, there really wasn't as much focus on the participation of women or the involvement of women on matters of peace and security, even though de facto that was happening anyway. And to that extent, women's contributions were not necessarily taken into consideration or sometimes even considered unnecessary. But after the passage of the Security Council Resolution 1325 and associated resolutions, there has been greater traction and a greater recognition of the absolute need to have women involved in peace-building processes if those processes are going to be successful. The United Nations Office to the African Union was established 10 years ago, and initially it was a liaison office. But it was upgraded and then subsequently is now at the level where, as I mentioned in my earlier response, our job is to oversee the partnership between the two organizations on matters of peace and security. And the Women, Peace and Security Agenda is an important part of that agenda. And so the kind of work that we've done with the AU over the last 4 or 5 years has been to work with the AU to establish the AU's institutional capacity to be able to build on the international Women, Peace and Security Agenda. And so, for instance, we've worked with the AU for the establishment of FemWise, which is a platform for women mediators on the continent, so that there cannot be a situation where women are not included in peace processes because they say there aren't any women. Because we've taken women from across the continent and involved them in training programs and capacity building programs, both those who are already experienced and therefore what we're doing is essentially adding to their knowledge and skill, and those who have expressed an interest of being involved in this area, just so that as a matter of fact, there is a roster of women mediators who can be called upon at short notice to be involved in peace building and mediation processes. We're also working with the African Union, not just to focus on women who are older and who have a certain level of experience already, but also to make sure that we include younger women, so that younger women are as equally as important a part of this process of involving women in peace building and recognizing the role of women in peace and security. We also work with the AU to provide operational support and to provide training for their operational support services as well, so that we can build capacity and the standard operating procedures that are developed by the AU are very much in line with international best practice standards and also standards that have been adopted by the United Nations in respect of its own peacekeeping, participation of troops and police in peacekeeping operations. So there's a whole gamut of activities that we oversee and that we engage on behalf of the United Nations with the African Union in the development and strengthening of these capacities so that we have a much greater involvement of African women in dealing with the peace and security challenges that we have on the continent.
You mentioned there about FemWise. Would you describe that as maybe one of the models of success you've had in developing a joint program with the African Union? And how would you describe that model and the work you've done with FemWise?
I think it's important to first point out that FemWise is an African Union initiative. With the support that we give from the UN office to the African Union sometimes focuses on joint initiatives, but in the case of FemWise, it is an AU initiative that is being supported by the United Nations. And I want to emphasize that because as much as possible, one of the things that we try to do is not to impose the UN's views of how to go about these issues on the African Union, but to provide as much support as we can to enable the AU to develop its own mechanisms in order to be able to take the lead on the resolution of the peace and security challenges of the continent. And I think that the work that we've done with FemWise has been very interesting and so far I think has yielded good results. Now, the challenge we have is that we've done a lot of training. We've done some deployment of FemWise mediators, which have been supported by the UN office to the African Union. We need to do much more. And so it's a question of being able to raise the funding to deploy these mediators in situations where their services are required so that they can contribute to peace building efforts. But I'm satisfied that we have been able to develop an adequate human resource capacity for this purpose.
And just one final follow-up question there. How important is that? You mentioned earlier on about the relationship not being about an imposition, but it's quite about a partnership. So how important is that structure in all partnership work across peace? And how effective do you think that has been achieved in partnerships development around peace and security in Africa?
I think that on the balance, we've been able to do quite well. We don't always agree on the respective approaches to deal with conflict situations on the continent, but then it would be unrealistic to expect that that would be the case. However, more often than not, we do have consensus and are able to work together using a joint approach and having the same objectives and looking for the same outcomes and working together to use our best efforts in peace-building situations. So I think that the partnership under the framework agreement, but the partnership across the various offices, agencies, funds, and programs of the United Nations and the African Union and the regional economic communities has gone quite well. And I think that it has been successful, but it has also had some challenges in working together on some of these initiatives. But again, in any human endeavor, you would expect that to be the case.
Yeah, absolutely. And if we're to move beyond the African Union now, you also work with other key agencies and bodies. How would you describe the partnership structures and the various levels of partnerships around peace building and also towards, particularly towards the effective implementation of the Women, Peace and Security Agenda?
We work primarily with the Department of Peace and Security and the Department of Political Affairs and the Office of the Chairperson. These are the three main offices of the African Union Commission that we engage with in order to be able to do our work together and to progress the partnership. But having said that, we also engage other organs and offices of the African Union as well. So for instance, we have been doing some work with the Panel of the Wise because FemWise is, as a matter of fact, an initiative of the Panel of the Wise. We have also been working with the Peace Fund, which has recently been established. And well, it was established earlier, but it has been, if you like, reset. And now a board of trustees has been put in place. And that board of trustees is working to make the Peace Fund operational as quickly as possible. On the issues of women, peace and security, we work with the Special Envoy on Women, Peace and Security, Madame Binetta Diop, in addition to the Commissioner for Peace and Security and the Commissioner for Political Affairs. We've also done quite a bit of work with the Office of the Youth Envoy, because again, we're focused not just on dealing with more matured women who have already occupied roles in various aspects of public life and are involved in peace building, but because we're committed to working with younger people as well. We have a joint UNAU initiative called the African Women's Leadership Network, which we are also involved in. That was spearheaded by UN Women and the African Union. But together with other UN offices, agencies, funds, and programs, we have worked with the Women's Leadership Network as well, again, to build capacity to deal with, among other issues, matters relating to peace and security. We also engage with the AU Peace and Security Council on a regular basis because given their role within the organizational structure of the African Union and the important part that they play in driving the decisions of the African Union on matters of peace and security, it's important to have regular engagement with them. There are other offices, other agencies, other organs of the African Union that we haven't worked as much with, but which I hope in future will be engaging more frequently, because the whole idea is that in developing and in implementing this partnership, we should be looking at strengthening the institutional infrastructure of the African Union that will allow it to play the role that is envisaged in terms of taking the, if you like, the lead position on dealing with the peace and security challenges of the continent, and specifically with reference to issues of women, peace and security, making sure that the gender agenda is incorporated in that process at every level of mediation and peace building processes.
And so, I mean, we've got a really good picture of your relationship with the African Union and various initiatives that have been jointly developed. But outside of the African Union, within your structures at the UNOAU and other partners, what is those partnership structures like? Who are the other players that you work with in order to achieve these initiatives and achieve your activities, both with the African Union, but also outside of it?
This is principally a partnership between the United Nations and the African Union. But on specific issues, we may work with other organizations or with other bilateral partners that may be interested in a particular set of activities. So, for instance, on the Women, Peace and Security agenda, we have been supported by the government of Norway. We've also been supported by the government of Sweden. And both of these countries have been very forward-looking in terms of the way in which they prioritize strengthening their structures in support of peace building. And on a case-by-case basis, or let's say on a specific project or initiative basis, we may work with other partners in order to be able to, together with the African Union, achieve what is an agreed agenda or outcome.
And so when we look at all those forms of partnership, so with the African Union and with other agencies that come on board on a case-by-case basis, as you said, what would you say has worked well in terms of, you know, these partnerships for peace, right? And what would you say perhaps need further reflection in order to get things right? What are the gaps that currently exist in those partnership frameworks and the way in which you work with different partners?
I think we've done a lot of work in terms of institutional capacity. Where we have started doing some work, but where I would acknowledge that we need to do much more, is in supporting actual implementation in country situations. Now, that is quite expensive because, of course, you're talking about deploying individuals, making sure that they are properly associated with ongoing initiatives so that they can plug into those and be aware of what is going on. And given the fact that very often in these circumstances, there are real peace and security challenges, making sure that their presence in any location is also accepted and at the same time encouraged by all the other key partners that the UN works with or are part of the UN and AU establishment to make sure that they receive the protection required to enable them to deploy and do their work properly. So I think that where we have more work to do and where I anticipated that we would have done a lot more work this year, were it not for the COVID pandemic, is on the issue of implementation and presence and having the women that we have supported to be trained actively involved in peace building processes.
So you'd say there's an important need to perhaps include maybe grassroots level incorporation into those partnership structures?
Oh, I don't have any doubt that it's important to do that. And indeed, in our thinking and in the way in which we even plan for deployment into those missions, we take that into consideration. But the challenge for us and what impacts our ability to do that is access to funding. And so it's always a question of, again, bringing together a lot of like-minded countries, institutions, organizations that also believe in the value of what it is that we want to do and are ready to financially support that process. And getting partners for implementation and participation in actual peace-building processes in country situations is the challenge that we would have focused on with much more intensity in the last year. And hopefully next year, as we come out of this pandemic, we will be working and engaging partners to see how we can do that much more than we have previously, so that we can see the added value of all the efforts that we have made.
My next question is going to be on COVID-19 and the impact on financial support and all that. But I just wanted to ask a more broader question before we lead into that. And that is, from your perspective and in your position at UNOAU, how would you describe the main, let's say, top three impact COVID-19 has had on your ability of whether it's UNOAU, African Union, or just generally the Women Peace Agenda implementation in Africa? What would you say are like the top three areas in which it's been impacted by COVID-19 and that perhaps we could begin to look at for next year?
As far as the impact of COVID is concerned, with regard to our meeting and our ongoing consultations with the African Union, that has continued more or less in the way it had previously. I would say at a slightly slower pace, because initially it took some time to develop the structures to be able to work together much more effectively online and using online tools, as opposed to meeting in person, which is what we used to do most of the time. And it's also affected the time that we have for these kind of engagements. And it also has affected our ability to engage both informally as well as formally. Because while we have formal processes of engagement to consult, to do joint analysis, to discuss with each other, sometimes it is the informal conversations that give additional insights into the issues that we need to be dealing with or the issues that we are dealing with, and helps to frame the way in which you would respond better. When we're talking about peace and security challenges, we're actually talking about real-life challenges not happening within the city of Addis or within the comfort of the offices of UNOAU or the African Union, but happening in member states across the continent. And so in those circumstances, clearly there is the need for a presence on the ground. And over the last year, as we have seen the impact of the COVID pandemic and we have been unable to travel as much as we previously used to, it has affected our ability to engage at the point of need where these issues have to be redressed. I mean, there have been some meetings that have taken place, and not necessarily within UNOAU, but with other UN offices that are involved in peace building activities where they've had online discussions. I mean, recently we've seen the work that was done by our colleagues in Libya, which resulted in the ceasefire agreement. And a lot of that discussion took place online as well as in person. But in other situations, an in-person presence would be desirable, and we just have not been able to do that as much as we would have liked to do. So I think that's really the main area in which COVID has impacted our work. But on the other hand, it has also made it clear to us that it's a better way of working would be not just to look at what we can do as institutions, but to strengthen our partnerships with organizations, civil society, organizational structures that have been put in place by regional economic communities, etc., and to find better ways of working with them so that when we are unable to have a presence at the point where physically all of these things are taking place, we can still have interlocutors working with us who will enable us to be able to do that outreach and still work actively on peace processes, even if we're not able to participate directly ourselves. But still, even though I think it's important for us to build on these mechanisms and see what we can do to strengthen them, the fact still remains that the impact of COVID has been that we have not been able to move around as much. We have not been able to engage at the points where these conflict situations have arisen. We have not been able to be as involved in preemptive peace-building activities, focusing on prevention as opposed to dealing with issues after the event, because again, not everybody is necessarily comfortable with discussing certain issues online. Sometimes access to the internet is an issue, and sometimes also there are trust issues with persons who are even involved in that discussion. And of course, once you have an online platform, there's always the possibility of a recording taking place, and so it makes people more cautious. So that's how I see that it has impacted the work that we've been doing.
COVID-19 has undoubtedly had so many impacts on so many levels across the Women, Peace and Security agenda. And so as governments, as funders and donors begin to plan their international development budgets and other such partnerships and financial support, what actions should be taken to scale up the commitment and investment into Women, Peace and Security agenda, and particularly in terms of enhancing partnerships and coordination at national, regional and global levels?
I think we have to rethink our working models, because while, you know, we can begin to see an end to the COVID pandemic within sight, now that there has been the availability of approved vaccines, the fact of the matter is that before we get to the point where enough people would have been vaccinated to enable us to go back to something like the way we used to work previously, it's going to take a while. There is also no doubt that the pandemic has financially impacted economies across our continent and also across the world. And so it is my anticipation that even with the best of intentions, it is not going to be as easy to get our partners to commit the same levels of funding to be able to support the agenda. So we have to rethink how we work in order to be able to do more with less. And I think I anticipate that that's going to be the situation for perhaps the next year, maybe the year afterwards. And so that's the reason why I'm saying that that is what we've got to be thinking about. As I just mentioned in my earlier response, we have to look at how we will build on partnerships, how we will still use the digital tools available to us. At the same time, how we will be able to build partnerships with local actors, with institutions, both regional and sub-regional, that are working within the areas, as well as UN country teams, offices, funds, and programs, and build those kind of partnerships in country that will allow those who are already present and working there to do a lot of the frontline work, which they're already doing, but this time to do it in collaboration with the regional partnership structure that we have. so that we are all better informed of the activities that we are undertaking, and we can make our responses a lot more well-coordinated and cohesive.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. If there was one parting perspective you would like to share with others listening to this podcast in terms of partnerships for peace, what would that be?
I think it's important for us to realize that unless we are able to make a huge effort to deal with issues of prevention, to look at our institutional structures and strengthen them, to have effective peace-building mechanisms, and at the same time to integrate that into a process of institutional reform in country, to strengthen the structures that exist in order to ensure that there is not a return to conflict after all of this hard work of peace building has been done. I think if we don't begin to change the way we think on how we approach these issues, then we will find that even though we've done a lot of work and we've put in a lot of effort, it may not necessarily have the desired outcomes. And the focus has to be not just on process, but on outcomes. Ultimately, what we want to achieve is to have the countries of this continent having strong institutions, internal dispute resolution mechanisms, and effective internal dispute resolution mechanisms, so that where there are the challenges of intrastate conflict, those challenges can be addressed and can be addressed from the lens of prevention as opposed to dealing with issues after the event. We need to be able to deal with the peace and security challenges of this continent in order to reduce the perceptions of risk that both internal Africans who have the funds and resources to invest and external investors have about our continent and the economic prospects for doing business, for getting involved in any particular social or economic activity that they want to pursue. It's going to be difficult to get the prosperity that we want to achieve under the SDG Agenda 2030 and under the Agenda 2063, which is to develop the Africa we want, if we are unable to deal with the peace and security challenges of our continent and not allow situations to escalate to the point where we are creating more problems than we already have. And so I think that it's important for us to focus some time, some energy on getting some traction in some of these long-standing, I wouldn't say peace processes, but long-standing conflict situations where peace processes are ongoing, so that we can actually say that we have arrived and we've moved beyond peace building and now we're looking much more on post-conflict reconstruction and development. And I think that if we can focus some attention on that and not assume that it will happen, you know, because the UN is involved and because the African Union is involved, but really to develop stronger coalitions to address these issues, we will be getting closer to addressing the economic challenges of this continent, because we can't begin to do that if we don't have peace, stability, and strong political institutions, strong governance institutions. And so that's what this partnership seeks to achieve. That's what the Women, Peace and Security Agenda is focused on, how we get there and how we work together with others to make sure that we arrive at that point so that the promise that we know exists in this continent can be achieved fully. That's what we want to do.
Thank you, SRSG Hanna Tetteh. This has been She Stands for Peace, the podcast series that explores the state of the Women, Peace and Security Agenda in Africa. I am Dr. Yemisi Akinbobola, your host. Join me for the next episode when I speak with Mr. Per Olsen Fridge, the Swedish State Secretary for International Development Cooperation.